Hi friends, welcome to our YouTube channel Knowledge Academy. The main aim of this lecture is to discuss about the EMT previous year questions of IAS in a very very detailed manner of electrical engineering. If you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button so whenever we upload a new video, the direct notifications comes to mobile. If any improvements needed in our lectures, then please do come in the comment section. We will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. So why to waste more time? So let's get started. So now we are going to solve the 51st question. See the question here. A parallel plate capacitor air capacitor. A parallel plate air capacitor carries a charge Q at its maximum withstand voltage V. If the capacitor is half filled with an insulating slab of dielectric constant 4, as shown in the figure given below, what are the maximum withstand voltage and the charge on the capacitor at this voltage respectively will be? So this question is same as the previous question what we have studied. So now we are going to solve this question. So out of these four options, option C, which is V, 2.5 Q, is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. So now we are going to solve this question as the previous one, which is this is a parallel plate capacitor. So for this parallel plate capacitor, initially there is nothing like a slab. So therefore the length is 12 and the width is W, and this is the distance between these parallel plates. So based on this data, what is the capacitance of this parallel plate capacitor, which is C volt? I am going to assume this is the old case or the first case, which is epsilon into area, where epsilon r is equal to 1 for air and the area is equal to 12 into W by the distance is D. So therefore 12 W is nothing but area. So epsilon into A by D. So capacitance is equal to charge by voltage. So initial charge is Q and the voltage across these plates is V. So now Q by V. So therefore A is equal to 12 W. So therefore now based on this, suppose if you are going to insert a dielectric slab, if a length of L, the original length is 12, means half of the length we are going to keep the dielectric slab of length or some insulating oil, which is epsilon r is equal to 4, then what is the net amount of charge and also the amount of voltage across these plates we need to figure out. See, already suppose the upper plate is a positive charge, so negative, so down plate will be negative charge. Always the electric field goes from the positive to the negative. So therefore we can say the electric field is parallel to the dielectric interface between these two dielectrics. So therefore we can say whenever the electric field is parallel to the dielectric interface, means we can blindly say that the capacitance are connected in a parallel manner. But if the electric field is perpendicular to the dielectric interface, then we can say the capacitance are connected in the series manner. So therefore C nu is equal to C1 plus C2. So C1 is the capacitance due to because of this dielectric oil. So therefore C1 is equal to epsilon r into A. Here area is L into W by D. So therefore here epsilon r value is 4, 4 into epsilon naught into area, where LW is called as the half of the area, so A by 2 by D. Whereas C2 is the area because of this air. So epsilon r into area by D. So epsilon r is nothing but, which is air value is 1 and area is L into W, which is half of the previous area, so A by 2 by D. So now we have to add these two values, C1 plus C2. If you do the simplification, we are going to get 2.5 into epsilon naught A by D, where epsilon naught A by D is nothing but, which is epsilon A by D is nothing but C volt. So C nu is equal to 2.5 into C volt. C nu is equal to Q nu by V nu, whereas C volt is nothing but Q by V. So 2.5 into Q is nothing but 2.5 Q by V. So by comparing the numerator and the denominator, finally we are going to get Q nu is equal to 2.5 Q and V nu is equal to V. So therefore Q nu is equal to 2.5 Q and V nu is equal to V. Means if you are going to keep a dielectric slab, then definitely we can say the charge is going to increase, whereas the voltage is going to remain as the previous one. So this is the correct solution of this question. So now we are going to solve the 52nd question. See the question here. A plane slab of dielectric having dielectric constant phi plays normal to a uniform field with flux density of 2 coulomb per meter square is uniformly polarized. The polarization of the slab is. So basically here in this question, they are given a dielectric slab of constant, or you can say dielectric slab with a constant value epsilon r is equal to phi, and also they are given the flux density in that slab is nothing but 2 coulomb per meter square. So based on this data, we have to find what is the net amount of polarization in the slab we need to figure out. So out of these four options, option B is the correct solution of this question, which is 1.6 into coulomb per meter square is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. See, already I have told you this one in the previous lecture itself, where D bar is equal to epsilon D bar plus P bar. P bar is called as a polarization, E bar is called as electric field intensity, whereas D bar is called as electric flux density. Or we can also say this epsilon naught into E bar is called as the flux density due to free charges, whereas P bar is called as the flux density due to bond charges. And if you do the summation, we are going to call it as the total flux density. And also I have proved you, which is D bar is equal to epsilon into E bar. But now I want to find what is the E bar. So E bar is equal to D bar by epsilon. So put this in this previous expression. So therefore D bar is equal to epsilon into D bar by epsilon plus P bar. But epsilon is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r. So epsilon naught epsilon is going to cancel, and take the remaining term left side and take the D bar common. We are going to get P bar is equal to D bar into 1 minus 1 by epsilon r. If you see clearly, epsilon r is a numerical value. So therefore this has no unit. So therefore whatever the unit of P bar is equal to the unit of the D bar. So therefore the unit of the P bar and D bar, which is coulomb per meter square, is the unit of electric flux density as well as the polarization. So in the question they are given the electric flux density, which is 2 coulomb per meter square, and the dielectric constant of the slab, which is 5. And so based on this data, we have to find what is the polarization of the slab. We need to figure out. So we know the relation, which is P is equal to D into 1 minus 1 by epsilon r. D is equal to 2 and epsilon r is equal to 5. And if you solve this one, 1 minus 1 by 5 is nothing but 4 by 5. So 2 into 4 by 5 is nothing but 8 by 5. And if you do the simplification, finally we are going to get 1.6. So the net amount of polarization of the slab, which is 1.6 coulomb per meter square, is the correct solution of this question. So now we are going to solve the 53rd question. See the question here. A flat slab of dielectric epsilon r is equal to 5 is placed normal to a uniform field with a flux density D is equal to 1 coulomb per meter square. The slab is uniformly polarized. So what is the polarization P of the slab in coulomb per meter square? We need to figure out. So this question is same as the previous one. So out of these four options, option A, 0.8 coulomb per meter square, is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. Before I solve this question, let me tell a small concept of polarization. Suppose this is a dielectric material. So dielectric material is also called as an insulator. So for the insulator, initially always the protons or neutrons are going to become in a same position, means the net charge is equal to 0. Suppose if you are going to keep this material in an external electric field, then what is going to happen, which is, see, whenever you are going to keep this material in the external electric field, definitely the positive charge are going to move in the direction of the electric field, whereas the negative charge is going to move in the opposite direction of the electric field. So because of that, the protons are going to move in the forward direction and the electrons are going to move in the negative direction. So we can say a small amount of electric field always goes from plus to minus, plus to minus, plus to minus, and plus to minus. So this we are going to call it as the internal electric field. But this is an external electric field. So therefore, see, what is the net amount of electric field inside this one? So therefore, the E resultant is equal to inside the dielectric, the resultant electric field will be E external minus E internal. So therefore, this is the amount of resultant electric field, means the resultant electric field will be lesser than the outer words. Suppose let me assume this is 5. But the opposition is 1. So overall value will be inside 4. So therefore we can say simply the net electric field inside is lesser than the external electric field. So if you do the simplification, finally the formula will be E external by epsilon r, where epsilon r is called as the relative permittivity of this dielectric slab. So resultant electric field will be always 1 by resultant electric field inside the dielectric slab is equal to E external by epsilon r, where epsilon r is called as the relative permittivity of this slab. Or simply, in the previous case only I have told you the relation between the P bar and D bar, which is P bar is equal to D bar into 1 minus 1 by epsilon r. And also in the question they are given epsilon r is equal to 5 and D is equal to 1 coulomb per meter square. So substitute these two values in the above expression, definitely we are going to get the 1 into 1 minus 1 by 5. So 1 minus 1 by 5 is nothing but 4 by 5. 4 by 5 is nothing but 0.8. So therefore polarization is equal to 0.8 coulomb per meter square is the correct solution of this question. So always remember, the electric field inside the dielectric slab will be lesser when compared to the external electric field, because always epsilon r is greater than are equal to 1. It is equal to 1 only for a free or vacuum, but for remaining every material it is always greater than 1. So therefore this ratio will be lesser. So therefore we can conclude that the electric field inside this dielectric slab will be always lesser when compared to the applied external electric field because of this opposition. So now we are going to solve the 54th question. See the question here. Two extensive homogeneous isotropic dielectrics meet on a plane. Z is equal to 0. For Z greater than or equal to 0, epsilon R1 is equal to 4, and for Z less than or equal to 0, epsilon R2 is equal to 2. A uniform electric field exists at Z greater than or equal to 0 as E1, and what is the value of the EZ2 in the region Z less than or equal to 0? See, basically, they are given a plane. Z is equal to 0 means nothing but XY plane. So above means Z greater than 0, and below the plane is Z less than 0. So in the question they are given epsilon R1 above the plane and also epsilon R2 below the plane also they have given. And also they are given what is the electric field intensity for Z greater than 0 also they have given. But now we have to find what is the electric field in the component of Z in the downward plane. Means for Z less than 0 we need to figure out. So out of these four options, option C which is 6AZ cap is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. See in the question they are given a plane, the dielectric plane is equal to Z is equal to 0. Above this plane the electric field is yx cap minus 2 ay cap plus 3 az cap volt per meter with a relative permittivity which is 4. But below this plane means Z less than 0, the relative permittivity value is 2, and we have to find what is electric field. But in the question they are specifying what is the electric field in the Z component we need to find in the below the plane we need to figure out. But we are going to find both of these values. So always see, this is a Z is equal to 0 means nothing but it is a XY plane. So this is called as the XY plane. See, always any plane is going to represent by its normal component. See, if this is equal to Z is equal to 0 means the normal of XY plane is nothing but AZ cap. So AZ cap is the component which is going to represent, it is going to represent the plane. If AZ cap is the normal means the remaining two components AX cap and AY cap are the parallel components. If this is normal means the remaining two components should be parallel. So therefore we can say AX cap and AY cap, AX cap comma AY cap are the parallel components. Whereas the AZ cap is called as the normal component of the interface of the dielectric. So therefore, we can say now we are going to split this electric field into two components. The tangential component also the normal component. So tangential components now is nothing but it is a parallel to the dielectric interface. Means the parallel components are X and Y. So these things we have to take. So therefore, only X and Y terms we have to take, which comes under the tangential part. And the remaining part will be normal component. So therefore, normal component will be 3AZ cap. But always there are two basic rules in the boundary conditions of the electric field between any two dielectric mediums, which is always the tangential component of the electric field will be always same in both the mediums. So E1T is equal to E22. Before that, electric field 2 is nothing but we are going to split into two parts, the tangential component and also the normal component. See, the electric field in the tangential component in the first part we know. So therefore E22 should be always equal to E1T. So therefore E1T value we know. So therefore E2T value will be equal to E1T. But the second condition in the boundary conditions of the electric field, which is D1 bar minus Dn2 bar is equal to rho s. In the question, they have not specified about the surface charge density which is present on this plane or interface. So we can assume which is 0. So therefore D1n minus Dn2 is equal to 0. If I take Dn to the right hand side, we are going to get D1n is equal to D2n. So D1n is nothing but epsilon naught into epsilon r into E1n, where D2n is nothing but epsilon naught into epsilon r into E2n. So epsilon naught going to get cancelled. Epsilon R1 is nothing but 4, and E1n is nothing but, which is already we know, which is 3az cap. Whereas epsilon R2 value is nothing but 2 into E2n bar. So therefore 2 1s are 2 2s are. So 3 into 2 is nothing but 6. So 6az cap. So finally we know the tangential component of the electric field in the second region and also the normal component in the second region. So basically we have to add these two things. So if we add these two things, finally we are going to get the net amount of electric field below the electric interface, which is 5az cap, 5x cap minus 2ay cap plus 6az cap. But specifically in the question they are asked only what is the component in the Z direction, which is 6. So 6az cap is the correct solution of this question. But if they ask what is the net amount of electric field below this interface, means this is expression, but they asked only what is the component in the Z direction in the below the region, which is 6az cap is the correct solution of this question. So now we are going to solve the 15th question. See the question here. Assertion: for a steady state, for steady currents in an arbitrary conductor, the current density is solenoidal, and the reason are the reciprocal of the resistance is the conductivity. So out of this statement and the reason, we have to find which one is the correct. So listen carefully. The assertion is a correct one, and the reason is a false. So option C is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. See, now I will discuss the conductivity equation, which is del dot j bar is equal to minus rho v by dou t. Suppose here current density is nothing but the ratio of current bar area. So the amount of current in a unit area is called as the current density. Suppose if current is a constant and area is a constant, then definitely this ratio is also constant. It indicates j is a constant value. So for constant currents, or we can say for steady currents, j vector is a constant. So differentiation of any constant value, so d by dx of any constant value is equal to 0. So therefore, if that, this is called as a divergence. So divergence of vector is nothing but it is doing a differentiation in the x direction, y direction and the z direction. If j bar is a constant, then definitely doing the differentiation in the x direction, y direction and the z direction is nothing but differentiation of constant value is equal to 0. So therefore, del dot j bar value we are going to get 0. So therefore, we can say here j bar is nothing but it is a solenoidal vector. See, if divergence of any vector is equal to 0, it indicates that vector is a solenoidal vector. So we can conclude that here j bar is nothing but it is a solenoidal vector. So in the assertion, they are given that for steady currents, or we can say for constant currents. See, for steady currents in an arbitrary conductor, the current density is solenoidal. Yes, we can see clearly steady currents means it is a constant current. So for constant currents, del dot j bar is equal to 0. It indicates that j bar is a solenoidal vector. So assertion is the correct one. Whereas for the reason here, G is equal to 1 by R, where R is called as resistance. So inverse of resistance is called as the conductance, and inverse of resistivity is called as the conductivity. So therefore, we can say R is equal to resistance, G is equal to conductance, rho is equal to resistivity, and sigma is equal to conductivity. But reason is wrong, because in the question they are given reason as the reciprocal of the resistance is conductivity. No, the reciprocal of resistance is the conductance. Reciprocal of resistivity is the conductivity. So therefore, reason is the wrong. Only assertion is correct and the reason is wrong. So therefore, this is the correct solution of this question. So now we are going to solve the 56th question. See the question here. Consider the following statements in connection with the boundary relation of the electric field. So basically in this question they are asking about the boundary conditions of the electric field. The first the statement one is, in a single medium the electric field is continuous. And statement two, the tangential components are the same on both sides of a boundary between the two dielectrics. And option three, the tangential electric field at the boundary of a dielectric and a current carrying conductor with finite conductivity is zero. And the statement four is, normal components of the flux density is continuous across the charge free boundary between the two dielectrics. So which of these statements are correct? So out of these four statements, which statements are the correct? See, statement 1, statement 2 and statement 4 are the correct, but the statement 3 is wrong. So now we are going to discuss the solution of this numerical. Now we are going to see these four statements one after the another. See, the first statement they have given, which is, in a single medium the electric field is continuous. Yes, always the electric field is continuous in a medium. It will be always continuous, means there will be no zero values or no discontinuous. And the statement two, they are given, the tangential components are the same on both sides of a boundary between the dielectrics. That is the first condition that we are going to learn in the dielectric concept, which is, in a dielectric interface, always the tangential component of the electric field in the first medium and the tangential component of the electric field in the second medium, both will be always same. This is the first rule we are going to get at the condition of the boundary condition, whenever we are going to see what is the nature of the electric field from one dielectric medium to the other dielectric medium. So therefore, E1T is equal to E2T means the tangential component of the electric field is continuous or same in both the dielectrics. And the statement 3 we are going to see, which is, suppose in the statement 3 they are given, the tangential electric field at the boundary of a dielectric and a current carrying conductor with finite conductivity is zero. So listen carefully here. In the question, suppose for infinite conductivity is nothing but it is a perfect conductor. So for a perfect conductor, what is the electric field inside? It will be zero, means the tangential component is equal to zero and also the normal component is equal to zero. But in the question, if you see clearly here, they have given, which is a The tangential electric field at the boundary of a dielectric and a current carrying conductor with finite conductivity. So always it has to be infinite conductivity. Only with infinite conductivity only the tangential part of the electric field will be zero. Suppose if you take a finite conductivity, if you take a finite conductivity means it is not a perfect conductor, means it is basically an insulator or dielectric, then definitely the tangential component will not be equal to zero. See, the tangential component of the electric field will be zero only if you are going to assume it is a infinite conductivity. Suppose if it is not equal to zero means it must be finite conductivity. But in the question they are given it is equal to zero, but they are saying it is a finite conductivity. It is wrong. So therefore we can say it is equal to zero only under one case, which has to be equal to infinite conductivity, or we can say it is a perfect conductor. Otherwise, for finite conductivity always it will be not equal to zero. And the statement 4, in the question statement 4 they are given the normal component of the flux density is continuous across the charge free boundary between the two dielectrics. This is the second condition we are going to get the boundary conditions of the electric field, which is d1 n minus dn2 is equal to rho s. Suppose if the surface charge means free surface charge density if it is equal to zero, then definitely if you keep here zero, then definitely d1 n is equal to d2 n. So therefore we can see the normal flux density in the dielectric medium 1 is equal to the normal flux density in the dielectric medium 2. So therefore we can say the normal component of the flux density is continuous or same across the charge free boundary, means the normal component of the electric flux density in the medium 1 and in the medium 2 both are equal only under one condition, which is when the free surface charge which is going to present on that boundary is zero. Otherwise both are non-continuous. So we can say clearly option statement 1, statement 2 and statement 4 are correct, but in the statement 3 is wrong, because it is equal to 0 only under when the conductivity is infinite. Otherwise it is not equal to 0 indicates it is a finite conductivity. So option 3 they have given wrong statement. So therefore this is the correct solution of this question. So now we are going to solve the 57th question. See the question here. The equation of continuity defines the relation between. So what is the continuity equation? How it is going to relate? What are the parameters it is going to relate? We need to figure out. So out of these four options, option D, which is the current density and the volume charge density. So option D is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. See, listen, suppose I am going to take some irregular body. This irregular body is going to contain some charge Q. So I am going to assume that the charge is leaking outward, means from this body the charge is going to move outward. So therefore this is a positive charge, it is going to move outward, means it is going to leak outside. See, the charge is going from this body to downward direction. So therefore current should be always in the down direction, means the flow of positive charge is nothing but the direction of the positive charge is called as the current. So therefore current should be downward. See, I am going to draw the diagram with respect to time, the charge on that body. See, as time goes on, the charge is going to move outward. It indicates that the charge in the body is going to decay. So then what is the slope of this graph? Means slope is nothing but dq by dt. So dq by dt will be negative because the graph is decaying. So slope is negative. But we want the current in the direction of the charge. Means we need a positive value. So therefore we are going to keep an extra minus, because dq by dt value itself is negative. But we want a positive value of current because that current is in the direction of the charge. So we have to add an extra minus. So this minus is going to add in such a way. So therefore the current will be in the direction of the charge flow outward. So therefore I is equal to minus dq by dt. Whereas charge is equal to, the amount of charge is equal to volume integral of rho v into dv. See, dv is a constant value, only variable is rho v. So therefore we can take this differentiation inside. So minus volume integral of rho v by dou t into dv. So this is the equation 1. See, I can write the current in another value also, which is in the terms of the closed surface integral of j bar dot ds bar. So we can convert any closed surface to a volume, which is by Gauss divergence theorem. So we are going to get volume integral of del dot j bar into dv. See, LHS is equal to RHS. LHS is same in both these equations. So therefore we have to equate this two values, means del dot j bar is equal to minus rho v by dou t. So therefore del dot j bar is equal to minus rho v by dou t. This is called as a continuity equation. Basically here j bar is called as a current density and rho v is called as the volume charge density. So continuity equation is going to relate two parameters, which are the current density and also volume charge density. So this is called as a continuity equation. Basically this equation, this law is going to based on the law of conservation of charge. So this equation is based on the law of conservation of charge. So based on this concept only we have derived this one, conservation of charge. So going to relate two parameters, which are the current density and the volume charge density. So now we are going to solve the 58th question. See the question here. Consider the arrangement of two equal and opposite charges of magnitude Q separated by an infinitesimal distance L as shown in the figure given below. If air bar is a unit vector in the direction of r cap and air theta cap is a unit vector in the direction of theta, the electric field at point P. So basically here there is a two charges Q and minus Q. They are going to separated by distance of L. So now based on this, we have to find what is the electric field at point P, which is at the distance of r from the center of this charge. So now here, air cap is the vector in the direction of r cap, r direction, and air theta cap is a unit vector in the direction of theta. So based on these parameters, we have to find what is the amount of net electric field E. So out of these four options, option C is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. This is a dipole charge, plus Q and minus Q. They are separated by distance of L. And also from the center of this dipole, there is a point P at distance of r, and the theta is the angle between these two vectors. So now we have to find what is the net amount of electric field at point P we need to figure out. See, I told the derivation of this, what is the voltage at point P and also electric field in my offline classes. So the voltage at the point P, which is Q into L into cos theta by 4 pi epsilon r square. Here Q into L is called as the P bar. Here Q into L is called as, actually it is called as a dipole moment, which is P bar. So therefore we can say P bar into air cap by 4 pi epsilon r square, because P bar is a vector from minus Q to plus Q. It is a vector dipole moment. It is going to go from minus charge to the plus charge. And this is air cap, it is in this direction. So the unit vector. So therefore we can say P bar into, see, P bar dot air cap is nothing but, it is nothing but mod of P bar into mod of air cap into cos of angle between them, which is theta. So mod of P bar is nothing but Q into L. This value is 1 into cos theta. So therefore we can say QL cos theta. So we are going to get same as the previous one, QL cos theta. So by 4 pi epsilon r square. So P bar magnitude is nothing but Q into L. At theta is the angle between the P bar and R bar. So therefore now, if you substitute here, E bar is equal to minus del V. We know the value of V. Just substitute here. You can say it is a gradient. Then we are going to get the electric field. If you substitute here and if you do simplification, finally we are going to get 2 pi cos theta by 4 pi epsilon r cube into air cap plus P sin theta by 4 pi epsilon r cube a theta cap. If you take P by 4 pi epsilon r cube is a common, we are going to get 2 cos theta air cap plus sin theta a theta cap. But P is nothing but QL. So if you substitute here in place of P, QL, you will get the same as the previous one. So therefore you are going to get, this is the net amount of electric field at any point in space. So this is the thing where you must remember, so therefore you can solve it. Otherwise simply remember one thing. So because of point charge, the voltage will be inversely proportional to R and electric field will be inversely proportional to square of the radius. But because of dipole, the voltage will be inversely proportional to square of the radius and electric field will be inversely proportional to cube of the radius. And also if you see clearly here, E bar is equal to minus of gradient of voltage. Why there is a minus sign, I will teach you now. See, always suppose this is the high potential and this is the low potential. Always the electric field travels from higher potential to the lower potential. This is the direction of the electric field. Whereas the gradient of voltage is always in the increasing direction of the voltage. Suppose if this is a voltage, suppose this is a voltage V. See, always the gradient vector will be always in the increasing direction of the vector. So this is the increasing direction, VL, VH means this increasing order. So therefore this will be the direction of the del V. Always gradient of the scalar potential will be always in the increasing direction of that function. So therefore this is del V, but electric field in the opposite direction. That is the reason you have to keep a negative direction, then only we are going to get the electric field. So always gradient of any scalar potential will be always in the direction of the increasing potential or increasing function, whereas electric field will be from the higher to lower. So therefore we can say that is the reason we are going to keep a negative sign in front of this del V in order to get the relation. So E bar is equal to minus del V. So if you keep this V substitute here and if you do simplification, we are going to get the electric field at any point in space P because of this dipole. So this is the correct solution of this question. You should remember this one. So now we are going to solve the 59th question. See the question here. The electric flux through a surface area is the integral of the, So here in this question they are asking what is the electric flux where surface area is the integral of the. So out of these four options, option A is the correct solution of this question, which is the normal component of the electric field over the area. So now we are going to solve this question. So option A is the correct solution of this question. See here, suppose there is a surface, some open surface. I want to find how much amount of electric flux is passing through the surface. I want to figure out. Suppose I am going to take a small amount of area on the surface, which is ds. So ds is nothing but it is a vector. So vector will be always perpendicular to that surface, means this vector will be always perpendicular to this surface. And also there is a small amount of field d bar which is going to pass through this surface with an angle of theta with respect to ds bar. So now the expression of the electric flux passing through this surface is equal to surface integral of d bar dot ds bar. So now I am going to do this d bar into two components. I am going to make it decompose into two components, which is the tangential component and also the normal component. The theta is the angle between the dn bar and d bar. If you see clearly, this ds bar and dn bar are in the same direction, whereas the dt bar and ds bar have an angle of 90 degrees with respect to them. So therefore I am going to write d bar is equal to dt bar plus dn bar. So dt bar plus dn bar dot product of ds bar. So if I take this one, I am going to do in these two components, which is surface integral of dt bar dot ds bar plus surface integral of dn bar dot ds bar. If you see clearly, dt bar and ds bar, these are two vectors orthogonal to each other. Ds bar in the perpendicular and dt bar both are perpendicular to each other, means angle between them is 90 degree. So dot product is nothing but cos. So cos of angle between them, so cos of 90 is nothing but 0. So therefore this overall value will become 0 because they are perpendicular to each other. So only thing we are going to remain is the surface integral of dn bar dot ds bar, and dn bar and ds bar in the same direction, so angle between them is 0. So cos 0 is nothing but 1. So therefore dn bar dot ds bar. So therefore surface integral is equal to total electric flux passing through the surface is equal to surface integral of dn bar dot ds bar. So we can simply say that the electric flux through a surface area is the integral of the normal component of field over the area. So we have to go for the normal component over the integration of the area, then we are going to get the overall electric flux passing through that surface. Now we are going to solve the last question of this lecture. See the question here. The electric field across a dielectric air interface is shown in the given figure. The surface charge density on the interface is. So basically they are given an air as one medium and the other is a dielectric, and also they are given the electric field intensity in the both the mediums also they have given. So now we have to find what is the amount of surface charge density, free surface charge density, which is going to present on this interface. We need to figure out. So out of these four options, option B is the correct solution of this question. So let's solve this numerical. So here in this question they are given an interface, and also above this interface there is a medium air of relative permittivity 1, and also below this one I am going to assume this is 1 because dielectric medium dielectric of epsilon r value 2. So I am going to assume this is the second medium and this is the first medium. So now electric field in the first medium is x cap, and the electric field in the second in the dielectric medium is in second region, which is 2x cap. If you see clearly, this E1 and E2 are perpendicular to the interface, means the components are x axis only are going to present. So therefore we can say here the normal to the interface is the ex cap. So if ex cap is a perpendicular to the interface, means only the normal component is going to give you the identity of the interface. So therefore if ex cap is perpendicular to interface, means the parallel components are the ay cap and az cap. So therefore we can say ay cap and az cap are the parallel components, and ex cap is a normal component, or we can say perpendicular component. See, I am going to decompose this electric field into two parameters, into two components, tangential component and also the normal component. See, tangential component should have y and z, but there is no y and z component, so therefore we can say it is equal to 0 and the remaining will be equal to normal component x cap. And similarly I am going to decompose the second electric field, which is E2 bar into tangential component and the normal component. Always by the rules of boundary conditions of electric field, always the tangential component should be always equal. Irrespective of the surface charge present on the interface, it will be always equal. So E2 is equal to E1T. As E1T itself is 0, so therefore E2 is also equal to 0. But if E2 is equal to 0, but we know E2 bar, which is 2x cap, so therefore E2 will be equal to same, 2x cap. And also the second condition in the electric field boundary conditions, which is dn1 minus dn2 is equal to rho s. this is a medium one and this is the medium two. So first medium minus second medium is equal to rho s. So d is nothing but d1n is equal to epsilon naught into epsilon r1 into e1n minus epsilon naught into epsilon r2 into e2n is equal to rho s. But here epsilon r1 value is 1 and e1n value which is only the take the magnitude value which is 1 minus epsilon naught into epsilon r2 is the medium 2 has a relative permittivity of 2 and E2n value you have to take only the magnitude value which is again 2. So 2 here. So this is epsilon naught, this is 4 epsilon naught, this is a negative. So epsilon naught minus 4 epsilon naught is nothing but minus 3 epsilon naught. So therefore we can say there is a free surface charge density of minus 3 epsilon naught. See, always remember one thing, always E1t is equal to E2t always. And also d1n minus d2n is equal to rho s. Means the tangential component of the electric field will be always same irrespective of the surface charge density, whereas the normal components are equal only under whenever the surface charge density is zero, otherwise they are discontinuous. So we can conclude that here based on these two formulas we have derived, which is the free surface charge present on this interface of the dielectrics, which is minus 3 epsilon naught, is the correct solution of this question. So by this lecture we have successfully completed the 60 questions of EMT of previous year questions of IES of electrical engineering in a very very detailed manner. And if you like the content of our channel, then please do like, share and subscribe our YouTube channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon button so whenever you upload a new video the direct notification comes from mobile. If any improvements in our lectures, then please do come in the comment section. We will definitely include all those improvements in the coming lectures. Thank you so much for watching this lecture. Keep smiling, take care.